were to try to define this generation that we're currently living in right now, how would you define it? We've lived through the age of enlightenment, we've lived through the age of reason. They say we're in the postmodern age. What should we call this age? The Reverend William Willimon, theologian and writer, puts it this way: our age shall be known not as the age of freedom, but as the age of anxiety. Now, last week I waxed poetically about freedom, since it was the 4th of July holiday weekend, and talked a little bit about how we tend to take a lot of our freedoms for granted. And these freedoms, or our loss of these freedoms, should be a source of some anxiety. And it is. If you're paying any attention at all, you'll see how those anxieties are being played out on the local and on the world stage each and every day, with government budgets being cut, legislation either passed or defeated or delayed. There's a cacophony of voices that ring out decrying the possibility of losing benefits, losing health care, losing subsidies. And to add to that, the baby boomer generation that's getting closer and closer to the nursing home age, and the anxieties they have about getting closer to meeting their end. Everyone across the globe seems to be anxious about a lot of things. If it's not safety or security, what will they call our age in our generation? When Jesus laments, "To what shall I compare this generation? It is like children calling to one another, 'We played the pipe for you, and you did not dance, and we wailed, and you did not mourn.'" We get the sense that Jesus is lamenting about a people who either are unwilling or unable to dance or to cry. We get a glimpse into the reason Jesus goes on to say, "Come to me, all of you that are weary and carrying heavy burdens." Jesus might as well have said, "Come to me, those of you who are anxious and worried." And we know in Jesus' day there was a lot to be anxious about. They were either anxious about the Romans and their dangerous and ruthless ways of putting down rabble rousers, or the anxiousness about the religious leaders and the burdens heaped upon their heads. They could be anxious about disease, disasters. In many ways, it sounds like 21st century America. Been reading a book about Abraham Lincoln and his struggle with his relationship with God. Kind of sounds funny, isn't it? We know about Lincoln's struggle with his upbringing, raised in a poor family, losing his mother at the age of 9. We know he struggled with his wife, who apparently was a piece of work. He struggled with a country that was trying to kill itself, literally. Struggled with his health, both mental and physical, so maybe we shouldn't be surprised he struggled with God. And his struggle with God may have come from, in some ways, his upbringing. His father was what they called a hard shell Baptist. He was introduced, or he introduced the family to the tent revivals, the tent meetings of the second great religious awakening, sometime between the 1800s, 1830. Lincoln, of course, was a man of reason and intellect. And these meetings were as much religious service as they were religious theater. People would be so taken with the spirit, they would shake, they would fall to the ground, they would bark, they would run relentlessly around the area. It was such a show, people would come, set up a barbecue just to watch the events of these tent meetings. Lincoln would witness this, and being a man of reason, he would simply find it too much to take. He actually wrote a pamphlet denouncing Christianity early in his 20s. A friend snatched it from him and threw it in the fire before he had a chance to publicize it, whether the story is apocryphal or not. If a man who has the potential for it and immense effect on people throughout his life would publish a pamphlet that denounces religion, you know that that is possible career suicide. And yet, if you read his second inaugural address and many of his later writings, if you read the purported final words of Abraham Lincoln, where he leaned over toward his wife, told her he wanted to see Jerusalem and walk in the footsteps of the Savior, right as Booth was squeezing the trigger. It's obvious that Lincoln was on a religious journey most of his life. Perhaps his anxiety about life and the situation he found himself as president with the Civil War, perhaps those all played a role in that transformation. What do we make sense of Jesus' explanation of this generation and then mentioning John the Baptist and the Son of Man? Was he frustrated that the people thought of John as an antisocial demoniac, Jesus as a drunkard and a friend of tax collectors and other sinners? In other words, the people were naming them as irrelevant in their lives, rejected simply for their deeds. It's a sense from the author of this book that I'm reading about Lincoln that Lincoln felt rejected by God for God's lack of deeds, his seeming capriciousness toward Lincoln throughout his life. It's a belief Lincoln felt cursed by God. And yet sprinkled throughout his writings and his addresses, he mentions Scripture. He mentions the presence of the Almighty. The man who dismissed Christianity in his early 20s seems to fully embrace God's sovereignty at the end of his life. Jesus goes on to say something interesting, something we all know. He says, wisdom is vindicated by her deeds. What shall be the wisdom and the legacy of our generation that we leave for generations to come? Will we simply be a generation of anxiety? What will be the legacy we leave for the people who come after us here at Trinity Lutheran Church in Lemoyne? Will we allow God's wisdom to lead us and guide us as we seek to do God's will, as we seek to increase our footprint in this community? Will our neighbors view us as people who are too anxious to mourn, to celebrate with them, or just too unwilling to care? As you know from my preaching over the last couple of weeks, mentioning the fragility of the ELCA, Lutherans in general, we've reached a turning point. Or at least we're close to a point of no return. We do not find ways to relate to our communities. There's a real possibility of sinking into our own graves of irrelevancy. So we've hit a turning point. It's obvious our churches aren't packed anymore like they used to. It appears the turning point for Lincoln, probably amongst many things, as is always the case in our lives, may have been the death of his father-in-law, the death of his son Eddie from tuberculosis. In his father-in-law's library, he found a book titled The Christian's Defense. And that's just a short version of the title. It's another 30 words. It's written by a local Presbyterian minister by the name of Reverend Smith. Springfield, Illinois. Lincoln consumed the book. In fact, he contacted the Reverend to get his own copy of it. It helped him work through his anxiousness about his son's death, but it seemed to help him through his anxiousness about his feeling that he was predestined to be left out of God's grace. It seemed to be a burden he carried through most of his life. We all have anxieties. Presidents, teachers, men, women, bankers, lawyers, doctors, Indian chiefs. We all have them. But we also have the wisdom of God that comes through the scriptures. If we're willing to take time to read them, to study them, to consume them, put some thought into them, that they may be a guide for our lives and a course of action when our anxieties begin to get the best of us. So what is our course of action if we wish to be relevant in the lives of the people in Lemoyne? Are we just to sit and wait for them to come to us? That doesn't seem to be working real well. Or are we going to take the mercy and love and grace of Jesus out to them, which in and of itself is an anxiety-producing thought, let alone putting it into action? Jesus, of course, tells us to cast our burdens upon him. And he will take them on, share them with us, for his shoulders are broad. He has yoked himself to us through the cross. What does it mean? What does that mean? Jesus has yoked himself to us. It means, first, and obviously, we need not bear the burdens of salvation. Jesus has already done that for us. So what Jesus asks in return is that we love God, we love our neighbor. And loving our neighbor means that we yoke ourselves to them as well, helping them to bear their burdens. We grieve with them when they experience loss. We give to people who are in need. We walk with people who have lost their way. What would it mean for you to yoke yourself to Jesus? I mean, more than you already have. Yoking ourselves to Jesus is not so much about intellectual reasoning. I believe that is one of the biggest, or was one of the biggest hurdles for Lincoln. Intellectual reasoning, though it didn't keep him from yoking himself to the love of God. You know, yoking ourselves to someone is about relationships. That's what it means to yoke ourselves to Jesus. Yoking ourselves to Jesus is like yoking ourselves to our spouses, to our best friends. It's an intimate relationship of knowledge, caring, relating. See, yes, Jesus was frustrated with his generation, refused to join in the dance and wanted to be left alone because they had to focus on their own needs and concerns and salvation, worried if they had done enough. There are a lot of people who feel the same way today, anxious about getting on with low salaries, dealing with health concerns, anxious about so many things they feel they are a burden to others, can't ask for help. So they try to handle their burdens on their own. And my friends, all that accomplishes, as we know from our own lives, is it gets us further off track, further separated from others. Jesus says, come to me. Come to me. Place your burdens upon me. We need to put that into practice by giving our burdens to Jesus and welcoming others. come into our midst, hoping to find some ease to their burdens as well. But we can't sit here and wait for them to come to us. We need to take this message out to the community, to let them know they need not face life alone. I ask you again to join me in going out to the community on August 27th to do just that. Amen. Thank you, Peanut Gallagher. 618.